All right, it is officially turkey time. We're gonna cook the turkey. Now, if you were joining me last night, what we did is we prepped the turkey beforehand, and I'll show you what it looks like. This is what I can't stand about Facebook, okay? So you hit go, and then there'll be like a little winding clock, and you can't tell if you're actually live or not, but you are live. So it makes it always, the beginning is always awkward, and the end is always awkward, because in the end, you have to go and you click like to stop the stream. And then it says, are you sure? And you're like, yes, I am sure. Let me turn down. Duke Ellington's got his band in the other room, and they're just waiting. Hey, guys, knock it down, huh? Yeah, turn those saxophones down. There you go. I like a little mood music while I'm cooking, and I put on jazz. I'm a big jazz fan. I put on jazz a lot because there's no words. And sometimes, like when Laura and I are together and we're cooking and we're having a good time, anything that has words to it is distracting because, you know, we're trying to talk, but we're hearing other words being inserted in the conversation. And so so I like to do a lot of instrumental music. I would say that in my very soul, I'm a blues man. So anything that has that comes from the fountain of creativity that is the blues, I like it. So that means I like blues, I like R&B, I like rock and roll, I like jazz, I like heavy metal, which if you really start taking heavy metal apart and look at the parts, it is absolutely the blues, just with a lot of distortion. I play old-timey music, and I actually really love it. I don't want to lose any friends here, so please don't get mad. I'm not really a big fan of bluegrass, which is different from old time. Bluegrass is great, and I can enjoy maybe three songs, and then it's time to move on. And the difference is that bluegrass is more of a performance-based music. It's virtuosic playing, and usually what it is it's singing, and then hotshot instrumentalists just ripping it up, and that's great. But it's also like I love metal, but I don't like shred music, like Steve Vai and Joe Satriani, where it's just hours of, you know, and I that's like, man, if you do that in the middle of a song, or you know, maybe one song on the album is kind of like that, but if everything is constantly 1,000 notes, it's too much on the ears. I don't know if you ever saw Amadeus, the movie about Mozart, which I love that movie. There's the king says to him, or the emperor of Austria, I think. They're like, oh, well, did you like the opera? And he's like, yeah, it was okay. And they're like, well, what was wrong with it? He's like, too many notes. Well, there's truth to that, man. You can have too many notes. Excuse me, COVID. No, I shouldn't mess around with that. I have allergies, and whenever we have shifting temperatures, I pay for it. Good morning, everybody. I'm sure I look like Bad Breath incarnate. If Bad Breath could form into a solid man, this is what it would look like. So we're going to take our time. I'm not going to try to like fill the air with me constantly blabbering or trying to be funny when I'm not. I'm clearly not funny. So last night, let me just tell you what we're going to do. Okay. So last night we prepped the turkey. What we did is we rubbed the cavity down with butter, and we put salt in there, and then the upper part we rubbed that down with olive oil, and we put salt, pepper, garlic, and herbs de Provence. So what is herbs de Provence? Don't worry, you don't have to go run to the grocery store and fight all the maniacs there to buy herbs de Provence. It's just a mix. It's got like fennel and rosemary and lavender, maybe something else. And the only reason why I used it is because I was too lazy to dig into my spice cabinet to find the rosemary. Because I think rosemary tastes really good on like roasted chicken and things like that. And I like it in bread too. Like if you bake bread with rosemary, and I just love the taste of rosemary. So that's what we did last night. So tonight we're going to prep this turkey, and I took it out. I took it out of the refrigerator. So let me back up. It spent all night with the salt. That's the most important part, but it spent all night with the salt on it. With salt and spices as well. Oh, there was garlic on everything too. And so that salt can really set in and soak into the skin. And that salt not only does make it delicious, but it's going to help it retain. Ooh, man, it is hot in here. I had to turn down the heat because I was, I get up in the morning, I turn it on to kind of toast up the house, and then I turn it back down again. But cooking and all this activity made me warm. So we let it sit in the refrigerator overnight. If you didn't do that last night, don't worry. It's okay. I mean, it's better, but you're still okay. If you're just starting now, grab some just butter. Now, I keep my butter out of the refrigerator, out of it. You know, a lot of people keep the butter in the refrigerator. I learned this when I lived in Portugal. I'll just say a person that I knew, she would keep her butter on the counter in a glass dish, but it was out and it's always soft. So you don't have to melt it. You don't have to put butter is designed not to have to be refrigerated. Now, if it's in the squares or in the blocks, yeah, put in the refrigerator. But when you're ready to use it or put a new butter in the butter dish, you leave it out and then it's always soft. So anyway, I just grabbed a big dollop of it and just went in there and rubbed the cavity down and then put salt in there. So that's going to help because you've got salt and butter on the inside kind of working. So overnight, here's what it looks like. By the way, I'm going to take my time. So if you're looking for a very succinct cooking show here, you're probably going to want to fast forward through a lot of my... that's what it looks like now. I don't know how good this camera is on the other side there, but you can see... we got all the spices on there. It smells good too. You know, it's got garlic on it, all those things. So, some real quick housekeeping. So, I have everything I do is my effort to market my books and myself as an author. And I will say that I'm very excited because this morning I woke up. One of the first things I do when I wake up, before I even get out of bed, is I check my Amazon sales. And I'll tell you this, this is how it works if you're an independent author like me. So, you know, if you got a book deal with a big publisher, they'll probably publish, you know, print up, you know, several thousand copies of your book and distribute it. You got an advance on your royalties, so it might take months and months and months for them to sell enough to exceed the amount of money they paid you in the advance. And you may never get there. And here's a hint. For those aspiring writers, you may never get there. And what might happen is you get like a $5,000 advance because they rolled the dice on you. And you might be a great author, but they rolled the dice on you to see, let's see if this guy catches or this gal, this person catches fire. And we're not going to invest any more than that. We've already invested in giving that person an advance. We've already invested in printing up that person's book and distributing them. Now let's see if it works. And they do, you know, they'll pick like 20 people every year to publish their first book. And if it's works, great. Everybody makes money and they come back and say, write another book. But if it doesn't work and you don't earn out that advance, they're not going to ask you for the money back, but they're not going to ask you to write another book for them. And it could have worked. But one of the things they do is they don't put any extra money into marketing. You still have to do all the things that you see me do. You still have to get people out there to buy the book. Now, I decided to circumvent that altogether and be my own master and go the independent route, publish through Amazon. And what happens when you do that, especially if you have a little bit of a following, is when you launch your book, and hopefully, you know, my first book, I didn't tell anybody I was writing it until, like, I knew it was done. So there was very little buildup to it. But I did okay. I launched the book, and I got some immediate sales from friends and family, mostly. And some people who are like, oh, a new guy, let's check this out. And so you get this surge of sale in the beginning, and then as you move on into the months thereafter, it's a trickle. And what you're hoping is to build up enough momentum to create a tipping point. You're pushing that boulder up the mountain, pushing your book out there, trying to get more and more people who do not know you to buy your book and give you a try. And once you get like enough people have read it, you're pushing that rock over you get to the tipping point over the top of the mountain, and the boulder rolls down and it's a snowball rolling down the hill, getting bigger. That is the path to success. So what happens is, you know, you go a couple days and nobody's bought your book, but then when they do, it's like a celebration, and every sale is a celebration for me. So I woke up today and I checked my sales charts for Amazon, and somebody bought both novels in paperback form. So they're available in paperback and in Kindle. So I'm really excited. It might have been one of you guys. It might have been one of you guys because I was pushing it last night. We'll see. But anyway, let's get on with this. So I'll be bringing that up because I'm always mentioning the book. And if you want to check it out, it's in the description, the link. And I'm pushing book two. Now, you could start with book two. I've written it in a way that if you haven't read book one, you could still enjoy it and understand it. But if you were like, no, I want to go to the beginning and read the whole thing, you can read Rampage on the River first. If you go to the link, which will take you to the Perils of Perryville, there'll be a path for you to go over and get Rampage on the River instead, or both of them if you want. If you really want to say, okay, you know what? I believe in this guy, man. I think he writes good stuff. I'm gonna buy both his books, as somebody did overnight. Somebody bought both my books overnight, so I'm very excited about that. All right, let's get to work. So what we're gonna do is we got this beautiful turkey, right? And it's been prepped all last night. Here we go. And I'm gonna let that sit over here. We're letting that get up to room temperature already. Wow, there's a lot of liquid that already has dripped out of it. So I'm gonna get rid of some of that. It's just brine. Blood. Because trust me, this pan is going to be full of liquid. By the way, if you're drinking and it's 7:51 Central Time, so if you're drinking already, I commend you. I'm going to have a little bit later on. I just ruined my hands. I just washed them and then I just touched the turkey again. I couldn't find the giblet. Okay, Annette Tidwell, if you're watching, you are absolutely right. The giblets were in the neck. I did not know that. See, I'm a good cook. There's still things. It's not because I'm an expert. It's because I'm a senpai, senior student. I'm still learning. I'm still learning all the time. All right, what we're going to do is we're going to melt some butter here. And the easiest way to do that is in the microwave. So I'm going to get a microwave safe bowl. We'll do this. All right. You see that? All right. Microwave safe bowl. Let's get some butter. Because butter makes everything better. Butter make it better, man. All right. I'm using salted butter. I think the recipe that I use, it's Martha Stewart. It's Martha Stewart's recipe. My dad, who's always made a good turkey. All my life, he's like, oh, son, you got to try this. And so I said, well, I did it, and perfect every time. Now, he's cooking a turkey today, and this is really cute to me. My dad, who is like my greatest hero of all time, my father has always been kind of a living cookbook. Like in my 20s and in my early days, I would call my dad and say, Dad, I'm making prime rib. What do I do? And my dad would be like, you know, like the civilian landing, the 747. My dad would like talk me through it. And so I've always been able to rely on my father to help me with cooking advice. I'm going to take these giblets or whatever they're called. It's the heart and some other junk, which is delicious. I love hearts. Hearts are good. I heart hearts. I heart them. Just use this. And so what I'm going to do, now these will only take like a half hour or so. I'm going to throw these in there, and during one of the times when I'm basting it, I'll take them out and eat them.
That's going to be a good snack.
God, we're going to eat so much this weekend. So here's Laura and my plan. We're going to, we're having turkey dinner. Now, I don't know if this is a Southern thing or if it's just, or this is widespread, but Laura's family eats Thanksgiving like at lunch. I think a lot of people do that. To me, Thanksgiving is like, it's a dinner and you have it, you know, you have a dinner, like, I think the proper time for dinner depends on where you are. When I lived in Portugal, dinner was like, you know, if you had dinner before 9 o'clock, you were a maniac. I think dinner between 7 and 9 is reasonable. I think the 7 o'clock hour for dinner is reasonable. This is white wine. It said to use, we're going to do a cup. Because I want a cup left over. I'm going to leave some of this left over for, let's see, it's 12 ounces. Yeah, it's not a whole lot. To help pull the gravy out of the pan later on. So we'll set that aside. I won't even talk about that now because it's just too confusing. All right, so what I've done, I'm not showing you any. I'm showing you my hairy chest and nothing else. Here we go. What am I looking at? Okay, yeah, this is butter, white wine, and let's put some garlic in there. Now, you could just use garlic powder. Garlic powder is great. I like this mint stuff because it's, here we go. I buy this at the grocery store. It's already cut, minced up, so I don't have to do the work. Hang on a second, I need a Kleenex. I swear, it's the allergies. I'm not... Nobody's going to get COVID watching me cook. Promise you that. All right. Here we go. So I'm going to let me put this back down here again. I'm my own cameraman. I have a beautiful camera woman, Laura, who does a great job when she's around. All right. So I'm just put a dollop. Am I measuring anything? No, I don't measure things. I don't measure things, man. Know what I'm doing? Not every once in a while I'm wrong, though. So let's put that in there and let that melt. So what we got here is 2 sticks of butter. Probably could use more, actually. I think the recipe, let me see what the recipe says. The recipe says even more. Let's see. I keep my recipes online. Let me give you a little hint, too, that this might help you. Let's see. 1.5, 3 sticks of... Okay, we're going to put a little bit more in there. So recipe sites, they're worse than porn sites. They're so full of bugs and things popping up and stuff that you weren't interested. Now, you know, I'm going to stick with that. I'm going to trust myself. I think this is going to be enough. And it's really frustrating because my computer is old and, I just put that in for 2 minutes. My computer is old and so it doesn't really handle like websites that have 30,000 like little windows popping up and so I can't even scroll down. My food's burning because I can't scroll down on my computer to see what I do next. So when I want to use a recipe off the internet, excuse me, I'll just take this off here. When I want to use a recipe from the internet, I'll go to that page and Safari, which is the browser I use, it's got this cool feature where you can hit it where it'll just make it one big thing of text that's easy to read as opposed to like the actual page. You know, it takes away all the ads and all the pop-up things so you can read something. I will highlight all copy and then I'll paste it in notes. So that when I want to go back to that recipe, I don't have to go to the web page and have like 30,000 advertisements clog up my computer and shut it down. I can just go offline and read it again. And so I keep all my recipes, not all, but a lot of my recipes are saved in my notes on my computer. I don't have to be online. And because I don't know if everybody can do this, but I'm on a Mac and I'm on an iPhone, I'm able to get into those recipes from my iPhone or from my computer. So like if I'm at Kroger I'm like, oh, I'm making chicken curry today, and I forgot what I need to get. I could just go to my phone and get right back into my recipes. So there it is. And I don't have to go back to the, you know, and I know I'm getting that recipe for free, and to pay for it, I should be looking at the ads. But, like, when the ads are shutting my computer down, it's not really helping me a whole lot. So I promise I looked at the ads once, but I'm going to read those that recipe for, you know, multiple times to go back to them. All right, so let's see what kind of damage I did here. Ooh, look at that. All right, let's mix this up a little bit. So show you what I've done. So that is a slurry of, I am not a good cameraman here, of butter and white wine and garlic. Yeah. Sometimes the butter is still, there's still some solid bits. Sometimes if you break it up, it's easier for it to melt in smaller pieces than try to melt it en masse. You know, I'm gonna add some salt to that too. Salt always helps everything. I'll put some salt in there. This is kosher salt. It's not as strong as the regular, and it kind of comes in flakes. I'm gonna put some pepper in there too. Yeah, this is white wine, and some more herbs to put the bones. This is white wine and butter. And like, if you ever have lobster or anything like that, you're not dipping it in pure butter. I mean, if they know what they're doing, and a lot of places don't, but it's a mix of butter and white wine. And the white wine kind of gives it a little bit, stretches it out a little bit, takes some of the intensity down. So, I mean, what were we talking about? I forgot. I do that all the time. Lord, get so, and thank you for those who actually sit through these videos. I have a tendency to like talk in circles. I start one subject and then I get sidetracked and I go to another one and then I never come back to the original thing I was talking about. All right, so this is cheesecloth, and you get this at Kroger. If you go to the section, that has all the cooking utensils and things like that, you can usually find it there. It's just, you know, up on the rack. Cheesecloth there. It's called cheesecloth. I believe that when you make cheese, you wrap the cheese in it while it's drying. I don't know anything about making cheese, but that's my it's my cutting board, so I have a clean surface here. All right, let's see how the butter's doing. Yeah, there we go. Now, this is hot, so if you spilt it on yourself, well, you probably would not have a good time. It would probably not be a good time. All right, the music stopped, so I'm going to go check it out. I don't think anybody's watching anyway. I'm going to go check it out. Take a look at that. All right, sorry about that. We went from Duke Ellington to Miles Davis. So we went from like music from the 40s to music of the 60s. This is Kinda Blue. If you're interested in getting into jazz, someone once told me, I was like young guy in Detroit, you know, hanging out with all these old guys that were, you know, jazz musicians, and I'm like, oh, I love jazz. I don't know anything about it. You know, how do I?
how do I get into jazz, man? Like, I really want to learn. Well, first of all, I learned a lot from the great Ed Love, who was a DJ in Detroit on WDET at night, and he'd have every Monday through Friday, he did jazz, and he did all, like, he wasn't into, you know, the new stuff. He was into, like, mainstream jazz, you know, not fusion, none of that crazy stuff, but just straight up jazz. All right, so what I did is I'm cutting these into strips, and all this is like a gauze, all right? It's gauze. Let's see here. Maybe I'm being too generous with these strips, because I need enough to cover the whole turkey. I'm going to cut it here. By the way, I was right about the butter. I'm not ashamed to point out when I'm right. I'm not. Like, if I'm right, and, you know, if I said something and I was it was in question, and it turned out that I'm right, I'm not ashamed to tell you that. I'm not ashamed to, you know, like, rub it into your face and say, you know, remember when you thought I was wrong? Remember when you thought I was wrong? Funny thing, turns out I was right. So anyway, it turns out I was right. So we are going to, let me get some more of this juice out here. This is just water, you know, because I think the turkeys have already been brined. So they got a lot of liquid, and that liquid seeps out overnight as it sits on this rack. And this is really important too. I know everything I'm saying is out of time and out of turn, but I have a roasting rack. So it's a rack that let me get the junk out of there. It's a rack that sits inside the pan. And what that does is it elevates the meat from the juices. And the biggest mistake that rookie cooks make all the time is they think that if the meat is sitting in liquid, it'll keep it moist and wet. No. It will actually do the opposite. It's reverse osmosis. It'll actually pull the moisture out of the meat, and what you'll have is a really good gravy, but like a dry husk of meat. So don't do that. You want to elevate your meat from its drippings if you want it to be moist and tender and all the things that we come to expect from good cooking. All right, here we go. So this is my gauze. It's probably going to be hot. It is. Let me get some tongs. Not thongs, tongs. You can wear whatever you want. If you want to wear a thong, that's fine. Just wear an apron so you don't burn yourself. All right, so we got, I'm just going to move that around there. And look at that. Oh, my God. This is just, you know, cotton, I think. Yeah, that one might be too long. So we're going to take that. It's kind of hot. So I'm using my tongs. And I'm just going to drape it over the turkey here. Just like that. Actually, I can get some of the giblets too. And this is going to help lock in the juice, man. You don't want to get too loose with the juice, man. All right, here we go. I write military history fiction. You want to protect your flanks. Always protect your flanks. We're protecting the flank right there. And we'll get the other one. Yeah, this needs to be cut in half. Ooh, that's hot. Oh my God, it's delicious though. You just took it. It's butter, white wine, and garlic. And salt in there. All my favorite friends all come together to say hi to me. All right. Take this piece. Yeah, it's a little hot, you know, but if you're not suffering a little bit for your art, then, you know, then was it really worth it? Was it? Was it worth it if you didn't suffer? That's what I want to know. Was it worth it? I think if you didn't suffer a little bit, you didn't cry, blood, sweat, and tears. So, you know, like, I see all these people on some of the writing pages for for creative writing, and they're complaining about no one buys their books on poetry. And you know, poetry's its thing, but and I guess poetry's good. I've never been a poetry fan. I'm not anti-poetry at all, but I've never really been a fan. And it's just, I don't know, it just seems like anybody can do it. And, I feel like, people who call themselves poets, our poetry is just an exercise in self-indulgence. Like, I think people would rather write poems than read somebody else's. Because to me, there's I'm probably wrong, so don't hate me, but to me, there's very little effort involved. You just... I can write a poem in 20 minutes or less. To write a novel is a commitment. You know, like the novel I'm writing right now, is going to take me over a year, just do the first draft. And so you have to have, it's great to write. Everybody can write. Everybody is creative. Everybody's creative. Everybody come up with, I got this great idea. What if space monsters showed up during the Civil War? You know, I don't know. Whatever you want to do. Oh, let's get this in while I'm blabbing. All right, so the oven is set at 450. I think that's going to work. Let me adjust these racks here. I set the oven for 450. I did that about an hour ago, to tell you the truth, just so we'd be ready. Martha Stewart says to put these in feet first, and then later on we're going to reverse that and put it in breast first. Does that make a difference? I don't know. I don't think I ever really paid attention to that part until this year. But anyway, here's our turkey covered in cheesecloth, soaked in butter and white wine. Shove that in there. Come on. And hopefully the door closes. You know what? My oven doesn't accommodate that. So we're gonna break the rules here. Alright, so 450. Just set that for a half hour. Now because I'm alone and I don't have my beautiful camera assistant with me. I'm probably not going to come back on live every time I do this, so let me tell you what I'm going to do. I need some water. We put the turkey in at 450, and we're going to let it go, and I'm going to, in a half hour, I'm going to baste it with... Remember this, our slurry of butter and white wine. I'm going to baste it and turn the temperature down to 350. And then I'm going to keep basting it every half hour I'm going to keep basting it. I'm going to baste it every half hour for an additional 2 hours at 350. Then I'm going to peel off that layer of cheesecloth that we put on there, and by that time we should have a pretty good thick skin on there that's going to help block in that moisture, and we might go for another hour until it's done. Laura's going to come get me at noon, so hopefully all this is done by then. Good thing we got started. I got up this morning. I usually get about 5:30. I don't even start an alarm. I just wake up, man. Today I slept in just a little bit. I think got up around maybe 6:30, but just enough time to make myself a little bit of breakfast. I am on a ketosis really lifestyle. I really figured this is the way. Back in the 90s, I put on a lot of weight. Like I was in college, I was lean mostly because I was starving, and chicks dug me, and everything was great. And then like in the mid 90s on after college, after my first marriage, I just got really porky and then got to a point where like I was really unhappy with my life. It wasn't the life I thought I was going to have. And so I walked away from the commercial production company I had with my mother, lost all that weight. And doing the Atkins thing, the low carb thing, and it's like magic. and went on this big thing. I went to Salt Lake City. I got a job with the Olympics in 2002 as a video technician. It was a great experience. Then I went to Japan and taught English in Japan for over a year. I met my second wife online, in which, by the way, who's a wonderful person, by the way, and I'm very happy that she and I have kind of reconciled and we're good friends. She's Portuguese. I ended up going to Portugal, lived there for over a year, taught English there. And what am I trying to say? Oh, yeah. And that was great. Like in Japan, I got down to like 187 pounds, man. I was studying kendo and karate and walking everywhere and good times. Got to Portugal. I was studying taekwondo. If you didn't know this about me, one of these little things that a lot of people don't know, I love martial arts. I love martial arts. Am I good at them? Probably not. Not anymore, maybe. But came back to America, and all of a sudden, you know, I was, you know, in America, you go park at one store at the strip mall, buy your stuff, get in your car, drive across the parking lot, park your car again, go into the other store. And so, you know, back in that American lifestyle, I just started putting on the weight. So like I was like 187 in Japan, which was actually too light for me. I was actually going without food there. Portugal, I did a lot better. I got up to 192 and I was eating and drinking very well. With abandon, but because I walked every day to work, I didn't have a car. Well, we had a car, but you know, in Europe, you don't take the car unless you're going to drive someone really far. Came back to America thinking I was bulletproof and just put on the weight and went from 192 all the way up to last February. I was like in the 150 range or 250 range. And I was like, I can't do this. So, I was like, well, what worked before? And it was the low carb thing. But I didn't want to give up carbs, and I certainly didn't want to give up drinking because, you know, I'm not an alcoholic. I don't know why we shame people who drink. Certainly some people have problems with it, some don't. I would say I'm an alcoholist. I love good whiskey. I love wine. I love beer, too, but I stopped drinking beer because it just fills me up, and I'm trying to cut my calories somewhere. So I came up with this plan, and this is what it was. I decided that I was only going to drink alcohol. Oh, I got a phone call. That's probably Laura. I'm going to let you guys go. I might be back later on to show you how this worked out. It is Laura. Okay. And.